I'm going to start with a poem by Clarissa Pinkola Estes. It's called Father Earth. There's a 10,000-year-old man no one knows. They cut into his rivers. They peeled wide pieces of hide from his legs. They left scorch marks on his buttocks. He did not cry out. No matter what they did to him, he did not cry out. He held firm. Now he raises his stabbed hands and whispers, "We can heal him yet." We begin the bandages, the cut, the needle, the grafts. Slowly, carefully, we turn his body face up. And under him, his lifelong lover, the old woman, is perfect and unmarked. He has laid upon his 2-million-year-old woman all this time, protecting her with his old back, with his old scarred back. And the soil beneath her is fertile and black with her tears. And I think the relevance of that will return later on as I describe. I'm going to offer you kind of a big picture view of what's happening to our planet, what's happening to our civilization, and how money fits into that, how the money system fits into that, and how the financial crisis fits into that. The financial crisis, which doesn't seem to be going away, seems to be changing form all the time as the debts, the unpayable debts, get passed from one place to another to another. But it doesn't seem to be going away. And I think that most people are beginning to understand that it isn't going to go away, that this isn't some small bump in the road, but that normal is falling apart and normal isn't going to come back. Most of us are in denial in one way or another about this. I'm in denial about it in a lot of ways. And certainly our elites are in denial about it, even if in private conversations they'll admit that their tools for fixing the system are impotent and that there's nothing that they can do except to pretend and extend, as they call it. This is an actual financial term today, pretend and extend. Keep it going a little longer and pretend that everything's normal. But privately or unconsciously, they're just like all the rest of us, understanding that the world as we know it isn't going to last that much longer. And I think all of the various 2012 myths and Armageddon type scenarios, they're all tapping into a valid realization that the way we're living is not sustainable. I mean, it's almost trite to say it today. So I'm going to offer kind of a larger picture to contain this change that we sense happening, this profound change, this change that goes all the way to the bottom. And that's one reason why I, in the title of my book, Sacred Economics, why I invoke sacred. It's to get at the sense that everything is included. In the book, I talk about a lot of economics in quite some detail. Tonight, I'm not going to talk a whole lot about actual economics, except maybe in a very broad way of understanding economics. Because really, what is economics? It's about the relationships of giving and receiving among human beings. And that's something everybody can understand. The relationships of giving and receiving among human beings. And a lot of what we know about that doesn't require any scholarly study. I'm just going to say a few things. Right now, I'm just going to tell you a few things that you already know. In fact, probably the most of the evening I'll be telling you things you already know. But one thing that you already know, that you knew especially clearly when you were 17, maybe 16, and maybe at times if your life forgot. But one thing that you know is that Mondays are not supposed to suck. Mondays are not supposed to suck. You're not supposed to hate Monday. You're not supposed to spend the whole week waiting for the weekend when for those 2 days you get to be yourself and do the things that you really want to do. And work isn't supposed to suck either. You're not supposed to spend your whole life working for retirement so that you can finally live. You are here. Here's another thing that you know. You are here with unique gifts that are meant to serve something greater than yourself. How do I know that you know this? Because almost everybody I talk to can describe a time when they were doing something that wasn't engaging their gifts and wasn't applying those gifts towards something that was meaningful to them. Probably many of you have had a job like that. And have you ever had that feeling, I wasn't put here on earth to do this? And there might be a lot of reasons why you're supposed to accept that job and it's supposed to accept living in that way. And certainly most of the voices around us are telling us that, well, you have to make a living and it's normal to hate Mondays. It's normal to hate school, which is preparation for life. And therefore, it's normal for life to be kind of a chore. So I want to get that. Yeah. I'm feeling so strange. I'm like so high up here. Maybe that puts me in a position of authority. Yes. All right. That's true. Yeah. Okay. You just have to help me get over this discomfort here. Every time I speak to large numbers of people, there's like a little part of me that's like, who the hell do you think you are? You know? And this is actually one of the things I might even talk about, this emergence of a collective wisdom that, for example, the Occupy movement was tapping into in understanding that the old models of hierarchical leadership are obsolete, and that even the nature of the organization needs to change. I've been noticing this also. You know, we're all going through a transition from an old world to a new world. And I'm going to explain a little bit about this. And probably all of us have had experiences of living in the new world and having the perceptions of a new world and having a different understanding of human purpose and human relatedness and having a different understanding of what's possible and even a different understanding of cause and effect and a different understanding of what's real. You've had these moments. I've had these moments. Most people have had these moments, whether it's time alone in nature or by the bedside of a dying person or lost in artistic creation or making love or having a psychedelic experience or a religious experience. We've all had these moments where it's just so obvious that this is the way human life is supposed to be. And then you think, yeah, I've got it now. But maybe it's a transformational seminar of some sort. Maybe it's even like a book, a spiritual book. And then you go back to the normal world and it pulls you back into the old perceptions. And you think, and for a while you're trying very hard to remember it. and trying very hard to do practices that will keep you in a more enlightened state, but it's impossible. The reason it's impossible is that this new world is not a place that anybody can occupy by themselves. It's a place that we can only enter and stay in groups. And so what I find what's happening today is that there's kind of a critical mass gathering. More and more people get it, and they can say to me, yeah, Charles, living by this logic, having these perceptions, it's not crazy, because we believe it too. And we can hold you in that other way of being even when all of the old institutions, for example, the money institution, are dragging you back. I'll return to that in a bit. Let me get a little bit more specific here. So, sacred economics. The title comes from the realization, well, okay, on the one hand, like everybody today knows that everything in the universe is sacred, right? But that's kind of an ideology. In our daily perceptions, we live in a world that seems to be shorn of its sacredness. And if anything in this world isn't sacred, it's money. Because money, in my daily experience, and in many people's daily experience, it's money that every time I have a generous impulse or a desire to play or a desire to be free, a desire to serve, there's that voice that says, well, but can you afford to do that? What about you? How are you going to make money if you make this career choice to serve, or if you give generously of your time? Like, what about you? I mean, I don't think I have to persuade you that money is very often a force for compromise of what we believe in, a force for, well, what's practical, a force toward doing things that don't really make your heart sing. And that's on a personal level. And on a collective level, you know, you look into any problem on the planet. You look into global warming. You look into habitat destruction. You look into desertification. You look into, in America, the prison industrial complex, the war on drugs. Almost any disturbing phenomenon. You look in and you say, why is that happening? Why is there a war building toward Iran? You know, why is it happening? And you ask why, and you keep asking why, and very soon you get to, well, somebody's making a profit from it. And money isn't on your side if you're trying to, say, restore ecosystems. But why shouldn't that be a get-rich-quick scheme? You know, why shouldn't you be able to make money from doing the beautiful things that the planet desperately needs right now, or that society desperately needs right now? Why is there so much more money in cutting down a forest and building a housing development, and so much less in restoring a forest? Why is there so much more in opening daycare centers so that people pay other people to take care of their kids, and so much less money in creating a neighborhood child care co-op where everybody takes care of each other's kids? Why is there so little money in social work and in all the service professions? Why should that be? Because money is supposed to be society's way of saying, here's what we think is valuable. Here's what's valuable. Here's what we want. Here's what we need. But it seems to be almost the opposite. Today, there are so many needs that are going unmet for lack of money. And so many people who have gifts that could meet those needs. But there's no money. Money shouldn't connect gifts and needs, and it's not working. And instead, it's encouraging us to do the things that are continuing to destroy the planet and society. And so that's kind of the question I start with. What is it about money that makes it not sacred? Because it doesn't have to be this way, right? Money isn't something that's written into the physical laws of the universe. It doesn't exist prior to humanity. It's money is nothing but a story. It's a story. It's a social agreement, a system of agreements that give power to symbols. In other words, it's magic. If you were an anthropologist and investigated a primitive tribe, and that tribe, and you report back to me, and you say, you know, that tribe, they're very superstitious. They write these symbols on cave walls or on pieces of parchment, and they imagine in their superstitious backwardness that they will change reality merely through the manipulation of symbols. But that's exactly what money does. Ben Bernanke can get up there and he can deliver an incomprehensible incantation. And millions of people can become unemployed. Someone who has the mastery of these magic symbols can write their inscription on a ritual chit and cause a skyscraper to rise or cause a business to fall. Can affect millions of people's lives through this magical power. And you can receive, just like in voodoo, you know, when they write mystical symbols and it gives you a heart attack or makes you their slave for life, you get that thing in the mail, it says account balance, and it could give you a heart attack, or more likely, you could become the slave for life of the people who have that magical power, which is given to them by our society. And those symbols are invested with power by our society. So money is a social creation. And we have created it as something that is destroying the earth. And so that was the question I'm starting with. Why is that? And what would have to happen to make money aligned with our newfound desire to heal the planet? So I looked into money and read a lot, trying to understand what it is about money that drives us toward destruction, toward selfishness, toward greed, toward anxiety, toward competition. Not that these things exist only because of money, but boy, it's obvious, money is sure central to those things. And I'll give you kind of a distilled version of part of it. It's very basic to money. It has to do with the way that money is created in our system. It's created as interest-bearing debt. And 10 years ago, a lot of people didn't know the way money is created. But today, a lot of people understand it. But for those of you who don't, I'm going to give a very quick and simplified version of it. Economics students and professors in the room might say, but what about this, but what about that? But in its basic outlines, it's accurate. So money is created through lending. I don't think I'll go into base money today how central banks create it, but let's just go to the level that we're more familiar with, bank lending. So when a bank lends you £1 million, it doesn't necessarily take that £1 million from somebody's savings account and transfer it into your savings account. But what it does is it creates that money through an accounting entry, £1 million. And money only gets transferred when checks get cleared and things like that. But let's just say, for simplicity, that it creates this money, and this is basically how it works, it creates that money in your account. £1 million for you, out of thin air. But I'm the bank, okay? And who am I going to give that £1 million to? Well, when that is created, a debt is created too. I give you £1 million, and now you owe me £2 million, because it's at whatever interest rate over however many years, okay? And how are you going to pay me back £2 million? Well, no problem, because you've got a good business plan. You're going to make money from everybody else in the room. You're going to make £3 million. You're going to pay me back £2 million, and you're going to have £1 million for yourself. You're going to be rich, okay? And not only that, you're going to make things that people like. You're going to go into the chocolate business and sell everybody chocolate. And they're going to give you money for that because it makes their life better. Okay, you're creating new goods that will make everybody's life better. Okay, good. So far, so good. So problem number one comes from the fact that this isn't just how some money is created. This is how all money is created. So everybody in this room has received £1 million loan with interest. Everybody in this room owes me £2 million. In other words, there's not enough money in the room to pay me back. Everybody is in competition with everybody else to earn never enough money. It's like a game of musical chairs. Even if you have New Age ideas about abundance mentality and yes, there is enough for all. I live in complete abundance and everybody can live in a complete abundance if they only believe that. Like that would be like playing musical chairs and saying there's enough chairs for everybody, but actually there are not enough chairs for everybody. So this would be a problem, a big problem. I mean, half of you would have to go bankrupt, basically, except for one thing. By the time your £2 million comes due, I will have created more money. I will have created even more money so that you can all pay me back. But more money comes with even more debt. But that's okay, because when that comes due, I will have created even more money. So it works as long as the system is growing. Now, who do I create it for? What allows me to create it? It's your good business plan, that you're going to be producing more goods and services. So the system works as long as there is growth, as long as the realm of goods and services continues to expand forever. It works fine if you believe that a finite planet can accommodate infinite growth. So that's a problem, isn't it? All right, so there you see, built into our money system is competition, scarcity, anxiety, and endless growth. Okay, it's built into the system, and when growth stops, then there's nobody with a good business plan for me to lend to anymore, so people start defaulting because no new money is created anymore to pay off all of these loans, and some people go broke, concentration of wealth increases, unemployment rises because no money's coming for you to hire people, and the whole system falls apart, and the only way to save it is either to take money from people who have it and give it away to people who don't and continue creating more money to keep the interest flowing, or to find some way to create more growth. And that's what governments have been trying to do for the last 30 years. Well, I mean, you could take it back farther than that. Find some way to keep the economy growing again. Find some new country that has raw materials, that has people who are still working in a gift economy and not in a service economy. You see, because there's basically two ways to grow the economy. One is to turn nature into product. The other is to turn relationships into services. So we see more and more things becoming product. Technology extends our reach to allow more things to become product, and service too. So for example, 200 years ago, communication was not a service. Communication was not something you paid for. Only with the telephone, the internet, and so forth did we begin to pay for that. 200 years ago, music was not something people paid for unless you were rich and, you know, went to the opera or something like that. But most people sang songs. Today, people purchase their entertainment rather than creating it themselves. Childcare, food preparation, the building of houses, all of these things people did for themselves, for their neighbors, in communities, in groups, and rarely paid for these things. And all of these have migrated into the money economy. When I was a kid, and When I was a kid, we never paid for bottled water. Right? One time I went to the restaurant with my dad, and there was a soda, and then there was Perrier. "What's Perrier?" I said. He said, "Perrier." He said, "That's water that rich people pay for." And that was like such a laughable concept. So I don't know how many people are here to learn about economics, or maybe some people are here to get rich. So I'm going to give you, I'll give you a business plan, okay? It's worked for thousands of years. Find something that people for free give to each other, or that they get for free from the land, take it away, and then sell it back. You can take it away in a lot of ways. In England, you pioneered one of the best ways to take it away, which was enclosure. So the land, you know, people, that was the land. You can't own the land, because the land wasn't created by any human being. The land was created by God. And no one should be able to own the land then. It belongs to everybody and to nobody. You haven't heard of a deed. So what you do is you divide it up into private property, and then no longer can you gather firewood and graze your animals and stuff, because it belongs to somebody else. And now you have to pay to live, whereas before you could live off the land. Okay, so that's one good way to make a profit. You can also do it through de-skilling. The skills of home building and even preparing food. I was talking with a local activist in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, where I live, and she said in her neighborhood, 2/3 of the people do not know how to cook oatmeal. They're completely dependent on fast food. And you can tell from the way that they look, too. So you can take away skills, you can make it illegal. Like, it's illegal to build your own house in America, and probably here too. You have to have all kinds of permits, you have to have a certified architect, and all these kind of things. So basically, we have this centuries-old conversion of life into money that is reaching its limit. Human life and biotic life into money, converting the planet into money, and it's reached its limit. And that's the origin of the crisis today. And you can keep the system going a little longer by finding still something that can still be converted into money, some new service. Maybe there's some country where people still have subsistence agriculture, and you can loan money to the government there, and if they won't take it, you make a coup, and so that they'll take it and loan them an interest, and then to pay it back, they have to convert to commodity agriculture, so you kick the peasants off the land, make them work in the banana plantation, make them work in the factory, generate foreign exchange, and now you have a market as well, because they're no longer subsisting without money in a gift economy, making their own clothes, singing their own songs, passing down their own knowledge, weaving their own stories, but they're paying for all of these things from Hollywood and so forth, right? So that's a business plan that you can use. That plan isn't working very well anymore because, like I said, we're running out of forests to convert into timber. We're running out of minerals in the ground to dig up and convert into products. We're running out of the atmosphere's absorptive capacity for our wastes that can be converted into money. We're running out of topsoil. We're running out of clean water. We're running out of the fisheries' ability to give us fish. We're running out of community. We're running out of the relationships that can still be monetized because there's almost nothing left, which is the reason why in many places, I don't know about here, it's probably not as bad here, but where I live, people don't know their neighbors at all. There's no community because we don't need each other because we buy everything. Okay, so that's this trend that's reaching its crescendo and causing a crisis that will never go away because the age of growth is over. We can grow a little bit more at the price of life itself, but not much more. So, let me put that inside a bigger picture. The system of agreements that we call money does not exist in isolation. It's part of larger stories, larger myths. The defining myths, in fact, of our civilization. There are two of them, two basic defining myths of our civilization. And I call them the story of the self and the story, I'm hitting puberty here, so excuse me. The story of the self and the story of the people. Every culture has one of these. And they answer the deep questions. Who are you? Why are you here? Where did you come from? Where are you going? What's important in life? Why are human beings here on Earth? What's valuable? For several hundred years, the answer to who are you has increasingly been, who you are is this discrete, separate individual among other discrete, separate individuals in an external universe that's separate from you. You are a bubble of psychology floating around inside a flesh robot. You are a soul encased in flesh. Religion, science, they all agree. Religion, you are a soul encased in flesh, separate from other souls and separate from God. Even if esoteric religions teach something differently, that is the general view of religion. Biology, you are, your essence is, it's these selfish genes that create or generate this flesh machine programmed to maximize your reproductive self-interest. Physics, you are, again, kind of a chemical, physical machine that operates according to deterministic laws in an objective universe. Okay, all of these kind of agree with each other. They're all obsolete, as you may have noticed. But they all agree with each other. And they imply separation. They imply that in this objective universe out there, more for me is less for you, because there's only a certain amount of stuff in there. And your interests and my interests are fundamentally in conflict. So money is part of the story. Money, in fact, makes that story true. In a money economy, because we're all in competition with each other for never enough money. You get that 2 million pounds, that's less for you. And you're not going to have enough to pay me back. In a different kind of economy, it's not true. It's not obvious, as it is today, that more for me is less for you. Therefore, to be a good person, I have to struggle against my nature and struggle against the nature of the universe and transcend biology and transcend myself and conquer these bad things in me, which right? Because if I'm programmed by my genes to maximize reproductive self-interest, I mean, that's pretty much the definition of evil. You know, I mean, I will do anything it takes to maximize my interest. So part of this whole story is what I would call the war against evil. Goodness comes through transcending this world in that story. A lot goes along with this. And it goes back, I said hundreds of years, it actually goes back thousands of years, all the way to the beginning of the war against nature, which this war against the self is a reflection of. The war against nature, which started back with agriculture. And the concept of evil started back with agriculture, too. So in a gift culture, for example, it's no longer true that more for you is less for me. Because in a gift culture, wealth does not come from how much you have. Wealth comes from how much you give. Because possessions, especially in a hunter-gatherer culture, possessions are a burden. So if you have more than you need, you're not going to carry them around with you. You're going to give them away. Because then everybody will owe me one. If I give all my stuff away, everyone will owe me one. If I have some hardship, people will take care of me too. And if you have some good luck, I'm happy. Because now you're going to share with me. More for you is more for me. Same in a primitive agricultural society. I have a great harvest this year. I have all this grain. It's going to rot. Rats are going to eat it. If I want status, if I want security, if I want everything that we associate with wealth, then I have to share it generously. And then when you have a good harvest, I'm going to be the first person you think of. Okay? So it's possible. And so the question then is, how can we transform our money system to take on that characteristic so that it is no longer a contradiction to our heart knowledge that more for you is more for me, that you are not separate from me. This is something that we know in our hearts, and this is something that we can feel. We can feel the truth of it. Why else would it hurt when you read about a species going extinct? Why else would it hurt to reading about the U.S. Navy's new like sonar things that are making whales go deaf? So what? That's just the whales. You know? What does that have to do with me? Who cares? But we can feel it. It hurts. Why does it hurt? It hurts because our story of the self is not true. What's true, it's the new story of the self, which is also very ancient, which you could call the connected self, or the self of interbeingness, which says, yeah, there's some of you in me, and some of me in you. We're not separate. Everything that happens to you, and everything that happens to any being, and anything that happens to the planet Earth is also happening to me. And I can feel it. From that story of the self, this contradiction between heart and mind, this contradiction between reason and feeling goes away. No longer do we have a system of logic that contradicts what we know. And today we're already transitioning into this new story of the self. Our consciousness is shifting. We no longer resonate with separation. We no longer believe it. But our institutions have not yet shifted. In fact, every single one of our institutions is built on separation. Not just the money system, but especially the money system is built on separation. It makes it true that more for you is less for me. It breaks apart communities. It creates scarcity. It creates competition beyond what is natural. It pulls people apart. You know, if we're in a gift relationship, I'm going to be late for work. I call my neighbor. Hey, can you watch my kids? They're coming home from school. Okay? And sure, my neighbor watches my kids. And I come back, thanks. Appreciate it, you know. And we go home and have dinner. Okay. Now my neighbor, he doesn't ask me for anything. But now he kind of knows that he feels like he has the right to ask me for something. Right? If you do someone a favor, then you kind of feel at liberty to ask a favor of them. And if someone does you a favor, you desire, in fact, to do something for them. So a gift creates a tie between two people. It creates a bond. But if I go to my neighbor's house, pick up my kids, how much do I owe you for that? Yeah, here's 10 pounds. Okay, what am I saying? I'm saying I don't want a bond with you. I don't want to owe you anything. I want this relationship to be clean, done. So a purchase does not create a bond. All right? And so that's one way that money separates people. And that's not necessarily bad, right? There's an appropriate relationship, an appropriate degree of connection that we have with different people in our lives. Maybe some relationships should be anonymous. Not a problem, except when we have a money system that has a growth imperative built in, which means that more and more and more of our relationships become depersonalized and anonymous. Until today, we're in the situation where even the most intimate relationships, like cooking food for somebody, I mean, even sex, but to some extent, has become commoditized in a lot of ways. But intimate things like cooking food for somebody, building somebody's house, singing a song to them, I mean, all of these things have become depersonalized, leaving us starving for the intimate, starving for the sacred, and starving for real connection. But we've been cut off from our connections to people, cut off from our connections to nature as well, through the process of the commodification of nature, which depersonalizes nature or anonymizes it, makes it generic. And so we're cut off from these relationships that make life rich and make life real. Cut off, we don't know the stories of the faces around us. Maybe in Totnes is a bit different. You have some community here still. And maybe you can look around the room and you know these people and they know you. But centuries ago, it was quite normal to know every face that you saw most of the time. And to be known by everybody really well, like you know everybody's parents' story. And you know the time that they fell down the hill when they were 5 years old. And you know their first love, the first time they fell in love. And they know you that well too. And being known so well, you know yourself. And there's not this deficit of being that comes from being cut off from all of our relationships. And to nature too, right? I mean, what's normal for a human being is to know the name of every hill and every tree and the use of every plant and what insects go on that plant and what the soil smells like in that plant and when it blossoms and what birds visit those blossoms and what their nests are made out of and the story of every hill, the mythological story and the personal stories and to be embedded in this web of relationship, and these are all cut off, which makes us hungry for consumption and hungry for money and hungry to grow this separate self that we've created with our ideology and our economic system, to grow this separate self in kind of this futile compensation for the lost infinity of our interconnected being. So it's good for business. And I think that's the origin of greed, actually. It's not this bad thing. It's just the reaction that we have from our cutoff. So the money system is part of this bigger story. This story is changing. And I could also explain how the medical system is built on separation, too. The conquering of nature, the control of bodily processes, and so forth. The educational system is based on it as well. Political system, legal system, you name it. But I won't go into all that. I want to tell you also the story of the people, of which money is also an integral part. So the story of the people, I call it the ascent of humanity. And it goes like this. It says, once upon a time, human beings were these little helpless animals, ignorant, superstitious. We didn't have science yet. All we had was myth and superstition. So we knew nothing about the universe, nothing about the world. We didn't have technology yet. Therefore, we were helpless against the forces of nature, barely surviving. Would have been bad news, but thanks to our big brains, we developed science. We developed technology. Knowledge replaced superstition. Technology replaced helplessness. And slowly but surely, we rose above nature to become the lords and masters of nature. And the story says, this process has come a long way, and life has gotten better and better, thanks to science and technology, but it's nothing compared to where we're going. Someday, complete mastery will be ours. Perhaps with nanotechnology and genetic engineering, we will extend our control down to the molecular level, and we will leave nature behind, in fact. We will transcend nature. We will go off into space. We will no longer be subject to natural limitations. We've already broken the sound barrier. We've already extended lifespans and conquered all of the great diseases. And soon we will conquer the rest. We will have 200-year lifespans. We will upload our consciousness into computers. We will conquer all disease. We will synthesize our food. We won't even need nature anymore. Okay? This story, does it sound a little obsolete to you? A little obsolete. But maybe some of the older people in the room remember in the 50s. Just how powerful it was. In the 50s, medical researchers would testify before Congress saying, yeah, the medical consensus is that all disease will be wiped out by the year 2000. People confidently predicted an age of leisure, thanks to the computer. Well, I mean, they were actually predicting it starting with the age of coal. You know, a machine does the work of 1,000 men, therefore, very soon we'll all be kind of the kings of these machine servants and we'll only have to work 1,000th as hard. Well, it turned out that didn't quite work, but it was electricity that was going to bring us into a realm of electrified comfort and leisure. And then that didn't work, so then it was going to be atomic power. And that didn't work, it was going to be the computer to replace mental labor, just like the machine replaced physical labor. That'll do it. So the futurist Alvin Toffler predicted in 1984, said by the year 2000, the greatest problem facing society will be what to do with all our leisure time. And he predicted 150 days of vacation a year, 30-hour work weeks, almost as good as a hunter-gatherer gets, actually. You guys know that, right? Hunter-gatherers typically work about 20 hours a week. They enjoy incredible leisure. Same with medieval peasants. If there wasn't a war going on, you know, they had like 150 saints' days off every year. And you can even catch there's a good film by Helena Norberg Hodge called Ancient Futures that documents what life was like in Ladakh, a very remote region of India before technology came in. Anyway, I'm getting off the topic. Okay, so the ascent of humanity, right? And so we don't believe in this anymore, this conquest of nature, which 100 years ago people would affirm enthusiastically. And a bright young person would aspire to being a captain of industry. And if you thought of a way to cut down forests faster, you were a hero, widely admired. And I think it's kind of progress that today, I mean, we're still doing it, but at least like people have to greenwash it, you know, and make excuses about it. We're no longer proud of it. And really the consciousness is shifting. And we're not believing in it anymore, partly because it's not working anymore. Like all diseases haven't been conquered by the year 2000. In fact, all of these new diseases have arisen seemingly out of nowhere. We don't have an age of leisure. We don't have the promised wealth. In fact, it seems like we're less and less able to do the things that we could do in the 1960s. Like what about free universal higher education, for example? Seems like we can no longer afford to do the things that we could once do. So this myth is becoming obsolete. And if it was once true, it was only temporarily true. Now, what are we transitioning to then? What's the new story of the people? And I'll just say kind of where I'm going. I mean, this is all a big picture stuff. This is all big picture, but what I do in my book is I say, okay, the old money system drives separation and growth, right? I explained that, endless growth, the ascent of humanity. So what are the new stories? What money system would be consistent with the story of the connected self, the interbeing self? And what money system would be consistent with the new story of the people, which obviously has something to do with the healing of the planet and rejoining the ecosystem, right? What would money have to look like then? In other words, what would money look like if it were aligned with the things that are becoming sacred to us today? If it were consistent with the new story of the people, if it were consistent with the consciousness that we're moving into? Let me just tell you quickly then the new story of the people. And I like to describe it through the lens of how the old story is ending. Sometimes ecologists say that human beings seem to be an exception to the law of nature, or that we imagine ourselves to be an exception because we just keep growing and growing and growing. But everything else in nature is at an equilibrium state of some sort. But actually, growth, periods of rapid growth, do happen in nature. For example, an immature ecosystem will grow exponentially for a while in its biomass. a child will grow very rapidly for a while and has like a final growth spurt in adolescence, and that's normal. What would be abnormal would be to try to continue that growth past its time. So what if humanity has been in childhood this whole time? And what if we, in the last century, have been experiencing this final growth spurt of adolescence? And what if right now we are entering into adulthood? How would we recognize that moment? When a child enters into adulthood, two things happen. Two things. One is that the child falls in love. And that love is different from the love of a child for a parent, which is all about receiving. And that's normal. My children receive from me, and I don't want them to hold back on receiving. That's their job, is to receive and to grow. But when you hit adolescence and you have this new kind of love relationship, it's not just about receiving anymore. You want to give something also. You want to give a gift to your sweetie, you know? And it's a mutual relationship. And at some point, you want to co-create together, too. Maybe create a family. It's a different kind of love. It's a new kind of love that comes with maturity. And I think that humanity is falling in love with Earth in that way. The multiple crises that we face are making our identity fall apart. Like, we don't even know what's real anymore. We have a sense of vertigo, almost. All of the things that were once so solid and predictable and reliable and permanent seeming are revealed as nothing but vapor, nothing but these tenuous webs of consensus that can just fall apart like that. Like money, for example, can fall apart like that. And how many people believe in the practicality and solidity of triple A bonds and blue chip stocks today, right? And your pension and all of these things. The world is falling apart, and we don't know who we are right now. We're entering this really pregnant time, this space between stories. And what's happening as the world falls apart and our pretensions to be separate from nature and the dominators and controllers of nature fall apart, what's happening is that we're being prepared to re-enter the tribe of all life on Earth and to take our place in ecology, where every being both gives and receives to the whole, and every being has an important role to play in the maintenance and well-being and development of the whole. That's what humanity is stepping into. At the beginning, it means, joining the tribe of all life on Earth. And at the beginning, it means probably to heal the damage that's been done, which will take many miracles, because the damage is tremendous. So all of that is a brief preface to the ideas in my book, which describe how to align money with the spirit of the gift, how to align money with ecology so that the economy is no longer an exception to the ecology, and not only how to transform money, but how to shrink the realm of money, but not eliminate money. Sometimes people think I'm about eliminating money. No, but to shrink the realm of money so that there is room for the qualitative, for the unmeasurable, for the intimate and the direct and the personal, to reclaim some of life from money. So I've been speaking for an hour. I should probably give you a few examples just to make it a little concrete. And after that, I will open up to questions, because it's a really long time to listen to a speaker for an hour, even a sparkling one like me. But really, like, I don't know. Like, if I'm sitting listening to a speaker for this long, I start to get resentful, you know, a little sullen, want to throw some spitballs, look out the window, go out and play. So I apologize for being long-winded, but I will just, I mean, this is kind of an artificial situation, but anyway. So let me just give you a couple examples. Some are pretty well known that I talk about. So how to make economy part of ecology. Well, that means that everything that we produce has to be able to go back into the ecosystem in a usable form for other beings. And we can't remove things from the ecosystem at a faster rate than we replenish them. For example, groundwater, or topsoil, or things like that. Today, the money system allows us to profit from the degradation of the biosphere. You don't have to pay for pollution, for example. So part of the picture, and many of you might be familiar with things like green taxes and the internalization of costs. But so, for example, what would it be like if it were extremely expensive to make pollution? Then there would be an incentive to devise technologies that reduced pollution or eliminated pollution. There would be an incentive to devise and implement recycling systems, reuse systems. Today, it's much cheaper to manufacture a plastic bottle and have it thrown in the landfill than it is to have glass bottles that you take to a refilling center and refill them with your beverage and then take them home again and then come back and refill them again and wash them out. That's a little bit more expensive. But that's only because plastic is so cheap. And why is plastic so cheap? It's because the manufacturer doesn't have to pay the costs of the pollution associated with making the plastic and the cost of the wars associated with keeping the supply of oil secure and the social costs and the medical costs and the costs to future generations and all of these costs, which need to be internalized so that plastic becomes so expensive that we don't use it except for a very, very well-considered purpose. And if you want to become rich, you could develop alternatives. Today, in the American Southwest, in the Central Valley of California, you can make money by pumping groundwater out of the ground unsustainably that can never get replenished, you know, for hundreds of or thousands of years. You don't have to pay for that groundwater. You're robbing it from future generations. Well, if that groundwater were extremely expensive, then there would be an economic incentive to use various dry farming techniques that are not economic today. Okay, so those are just some examples. And those are pretty well known. So I won't spend more time on those. I mean, basically, I'm just trying to let you know that this isn't a pie in the sky. One of the most important pieces is to reverse the effects of interest. I mentioned the primitive agriculturalist, you know, with his big warehouse full of grain. And to be wealthy, he has to give it away somehow. Ideally, he'll give it to people who, if he's selfish, he'll give it to people who will give it back. But it's actually very complicated because they live in community. So it almost doesn't matter who you give it to because your generosity and magnificence will be witnessed and people will want to give to you too. Why isn't money like that? Like, I have more grain than I need, I'm going to give it away. I have more money than I need, why don't I give it away? Well, one reason is that money doesn't decay like the grain does. If I have... there's maybe 250 people in here. So if I have 500 loaves of bread, and I'm a selfish bastard, I have no altruism whatsoever. I don't have an idealistic bone in my body. It's still not to my advantage to keep all the bread for myself. It'll go stale. It's to my advantage to give everybody two loaves and say, this is a loan at call. When I'm hungry, then I'm going to demand two fresh loaves from you. But I don't have the leverage to say, I'm going to demand three loaves from you. Because you can say, screw you, your bread's going to go bad. Right? I don't have that leverage. So one of the ideas that I play with is what would happen if money decayed, just like everything else in the universe? What would happen if money were no longer an exception to nature's law of return? That all things decay and return to their source. What if money were not this unnatural thing, but were just like everything else in the universe? Well, then I would have, it would be in my interest to lend money at zero interest. Or at much, because if I keep it to myself, like today, if you have a lot of money, you are pretty much assured of being able to get richer and richer and richer. It's getting harder today. But even today, if you have enough money, you can invest it at essentially zero risk, because if your bets go bad, the government will bail you out to save the financial system. Money breeds more money. So you can become rich by having rather than by sharing. Negative interest reverses that. So it allows the money system to work in the context of zero growth. Because now you don't need a business plan that's going to make 2 million pounds for me to lend you money. All you need is a business plan that's going to make 1 million pounds. So there's no longer a growth imperative in the system. And I can phrase this in economic jargon too. It allows lending to happen when the marginal return on investment, when the marginal efficiency of capital is zero. And that's a profound change, actually. It removes the growth imperative. And one more thing that it does is it reverses the discounting of the future. So let me give you an example. Okay, and I think I'm going to maybe end with this. There's other things, too. The other pillars are localization, peer-to-peer economics, Georgist economics, the reclamation of the commons, and a social dividend, or basic income, as it's also called. But let me just give you one more scenario to help you understand just how powerful it is to reverse interest. And by the way that it would be implemented for those of you who have an economics mind is today it would be as a liquidity tax on reserves in the central bank. And from there, it would radiate out through the entire financial system. So, checking accounts might be at negative 5% interest, savings accounts may be negative 3%, time deposits may be negative 2%, short-term government bonds may be around negative 3%, prime loans may be at around 0%, risky loans may be 2 or 3 or 5%, okay, whatever. It's in the book. And it does work. It's not a half-baked idea. I mean, this John Maynard Keynes thought that it could work, and some pretty mainstream economists have kind of toyed with the idea, not really seriously, but there's papers out there that I cite in the book. All right, so imagine that you own a forest, okay? And you have a choice. Either you can clear cut the forest and build a parking lot there, and you can make 100 million pounds, it's a big forest, by doing that. 100 million pounds by destroying that land forever. Instant profit, 100 million pounds. Or you can log it sustainably forever and earn 1 million pounds a year. What would you rather do? How many people would clear cut that baby? Raise your hand. Clear cut. All right. Because, of course, if you clear cut it, you take that 100 million pounds, you put it at interest, you're going to make more than 1 million a year. Probably make 2 or 3 million a year. Okay. And if you're the CEO of a company and you say, well, I know I could make more, but I'm not going to do that because I'm such a nice guy, then your shareholders could sue you for not maximizing, for not carrying out your fiduciary responsibilities. Or a corporate raider could come and say, hey, your company's poorly managed. You could have a revenue flow of 3 million pounds a year. You're only getting 1 million from this asset. So that's why your stock price is too low. So I'm going to borrow money from an investment bank, buy your company, sell off the forest, clear cut it, raise the stock price by increasing your revenue flow, sell the stock back onto the market, reap that profit, pay back the investment bank. Okay, and that's how this actually happens. Okay, and the only way you as a CEO can defend yourself against the hostile takeover is to cut down the forest, raise your revenues, raise your stock price. Okay. Anyway, market discipline hardens a soft heart. So imagine, let's just extend this metaphor a bit. Suppose you're the president of the world, and you have dictatorial powers, and aliens come, and they say, I'd like to make you a deal. Right now, Earth is, well, it's not sustainable, but you could generate sustainable income from Earth of $10 trillion a year. But we'll make you a deal. We'll pay you $10 quadrillion for the Earth. And we're going to suck the oceans dry and pulverize the planet and make bricks out of it. But think of how rich you'll be. Would you accept that deal on behalf of the Earth? You wouldn't, but collectively we are. We're doing that. And it's because of the logic of interest. If interest were negative, if money decayed, it would be different. Then you'd rather have £1 million a year than £100 million right now. Because you have that 100 million, you have to find something to do with that, someone to give it to who can use it so that it doesn't decay. Okay, I'm done.